unsurprisingly today. And there are two things which we are obsessed about. One of them, and that's the biggest thing we're obsessed about, is usability, right? So our thesis is that people will use protocols not when the consensus is super cool, not when the underlying data structure is super cool. People will use them when they can actually use it, right? If you need, if to buy a CryptoKitty, you need to go to Coinbase, send them your passport, wait for a few days, people will not be playing CryptoKitties, right? We call ourselves a CPC coin. Well, it's to contrast with the many so-called professor coins which exist in the field, right? So we have many people who were doing competitive programming back in the day. We have 6 gold medals in ACPC among a total of 20 engineers in the team. So it's and everybody has like between 5 and 10 years of industry experience since then. It's a pretty strong team. Many people from MySQL. I was the first engineer at MySQL, so I built most of the sharding that was shipped in the early versions of it. Okay, so first let me quickly talk about UX. So one thing is, if you go right now to near.dev, you will see this IDE, in which in one click, you see this run button. You can deploy it on the test and run. So as you iterate, in one click, you can always see what's happening. And all the tracing, all the logging you do, goes to the console of your browser. Right, so development is extremely streamlined. You can run tests. Front-end, if you see on the left, the bottom part, front-end is part of the package. You're building your smart contract and the front end of it simultaneously. Those are not two separate entities. You can test how it looks, how it runs immediately from the IDE. If you went to DevCon, you would have seen a thing called Studio, an Ethereum Studio, which very closely, suspiciously closely resembles this. And it's TypeScript. It's a language that everybody knows. It's not any obscure language. Many protocols are very proud of their obscure languages. We are not. And you can also use Rust. Then wallet, we don't do it today, but if you went to any of our events yesterday or on Monday, we were charging people for pizza using a near wallet. Well, you can get test token for free, but what we're striving for is for experience where a user who has no idea what blockchain is can open an application built on near and start interacting with it immediately. No gas fees, no MetaMask, no private key pairs or anything like that. Now that should sound very suspicious to any of you who deeply understands technology. That cannot be happening possibly. All of those exist because that's what makes protocols secure, right? We have MetaMask, we have key pairs because protocols need to be secure. But what's important is that if you're just joining the protocol, like you just want to buy a 10-cent CryptoKitty, you don't care about the security that the person who has 2,000, you know, 2 million worth of Bitcoin. Like your level of security needs to be significantly less, and there's the scale from highest security, lowest usability, to highest usability, lowest security, right? And so for highest security, you do need MetaMask, but also you do need MetaMask from source, which you personally examined, or someone whom you trust examined. When you install MetaMask from Play Store, you get zero security between MetaMask developers, Play Store, person who, like, in between you and Play Store, each of them could, you're not secure at all. So installing MetaMask from Play Store is not any more secure than just using a hosted wallet, and that's exactly what we propose to use for people initially. And the biggest thing with that, and hosted wallets exist for Ethereum, right? It's not something that is like brand new. But the big thing that we build on top of that is that on near account is not defined by the key. In near account is defined by account ID, and key can be changed. So if you started using any application on a hosted wallet or on a wallet you installed from a store, which you cannot trust, once again, then ultimately, once you do need full security, you don't need to create a brand new account and try to move all your assets. You just change the key on your account, which is a very, very simple iteration, right? And so, so it reduces hassle, but also some use cases are completely impossible today. For example, today if you have locked assets, if you locked your Ether for Edgeware, for example, and then you suddenly suspect that your private key might have leaked, well, you pillaged. You cannot do anything. Your Ether is locked. You cannot transfer it anywhere. Cool, so that's more or less it about usability. Now let's quickly cover sharding. So conveniently, RJ already covered a lot about sharding, but so Harmony and us are similar in this aspect, we both build sharding. So in short, sharding is when instead of having one blockchain, you have multiple blockchains. And each of them is somewhat fast, but X of that is X times faster, and that's how we solve scalability, right? There are many problems with that. One of them is the fact that each chain will have lower security, and the common approach that is used by practically every sharded protocol today is to sample from a large validator set using some unbiasable randomness or slightly biasable randomness. And the hypothesis is that if the initial set has very little number of malicious actors, then the sample will have slightly higher, like within the variance, number of malicious actors. That logic is great, except that there is a problem, which is those validators, they're staying for a while, right? Because when they join a short, they need to download the state for the short. The state is pretty big. It takes time. It takes like hours at least, maybe half a day. So they're staying for a day. One day is more than sufficient to identify the validators that were sampled and corrupt them, right? Because if you think about validators, their primary goal is making money, right? They're not running nodes because they're huge fans of the protocols. They're making money, right? They're professional validators investing heavily into their hardware. They also need to buy tokens, right? That's a business. And many of them happen to be in the same channels. You know, like they would be in the same Discord channel, in the same Telegram group. They're very easily reachable. So adaptive corruption, it's not super likely to happen, but it is way more likely to happen than you should be comfortable for a protocol you're using for secure assets. Right, and so the biggest problem that can happen with adaptive corruption is called invalid state transition. It's not forking. Many people try to defend against forks in the short chains. That problem is solved. Invalid state transition is a way bigger problem. I'm not going to go too deeply. I'm going to give links at the end to familiarize more. There are solutions. One of the biggest ones is called Fisherman. That's what Polkadot, for example, uses in us. Fisherman also relies on many things which were not quite solved early, like even earlier this year. The biggest one being that if malicious actors had enough power in the short to create an invalid block, that means they have enough power to not show that block to anyone. They don't really need to distribute it, right? And so the fishermen cannot even create the challenge because they will not see the block to begin with. That's called a data availability problem, one of the biggest problems in both layer one and layer two. I mean, sharded layer one and any layer two. And so one big problem that we discovered earlier this year is that if you try to solve all those problems, if you try to bake all of that into a protocol, the protocol becomes so complex that you can easily describe it on paper, but building it becomes practically impossible, right? And so we significantly simplified design in April. We call it Nightshade. You can just go to the website. There's a paper. It's called near. The link is near.ai/nightshade. But in short, what it does is it removes all the short chains. Orchestrating 1,000 chains is extremely complex. With a single chain, and it just shorts blocks instead. So instead of having 1,000 chains, we have blocks, and every block is split into 1,000 parts, which are distributed separately. It simplifies design tremendously. Like, for example, the fisherman, right? Before fisherman challenges a block, and there was a cross-shard transaction from the block to another shard, that's very complex, because now you need to unroll that shard. If that shard was sending cross-shard transactions, you need to unroll that shard. That causes the chain effect. If there's a single chain, it's significantly simpler. If a fisherman spots a problem in the block, that chain is unrolled. There's one chain to unroll, simpler to build, fewer opportunities to make a mistake, more secure protocol. It also enables many other cool things. For example, adaptive corruption, which we just discussed, becomes significantly more complex in the sense that what you can do with a single chain is that you can make validators who validate shards not to be known to everybody else. So everybody knows the whole set of validators, but nobody knows which shard every validator is assigned to. Because validators are not producing and not validating blocks on separate chains. They're validating the same chain. They can assign blocks on a single chain. So there's no reason for everybody else outside to know who they are. And that makes adaptive corruption tremendously more complex because you don't know whom to corrupt. Right? You will have to broadcast your intent. And that becomes significantly more complex for the adversary. Yes. Cool. So many things we didn't cover. So Nightshade is near.ai/nightshade if you want to read more about it. One thing I want you guys to know, if you never heard about it before, is Whiteboard Series. It's a video blog we're running where we talk to other protocols. So Zaki was the first guest. But since then we had 26 episodes with protocols such as Cosmos, Polkadot, Ethereum, Coda, Solana, Harmony. They were all guests at the Whiteboard Series. It's a 1 hour long episode, very, very deep technical dives. And we challenge those guys. We don't allow them just, you know, to do their BS. We run a beta program. If you're building an application, you want to try our awesome development experience, user experience. It's near.org, at near protocol. We're also running our incentivized testnet. It's near.ai/stakewars. Thank you.